Welcome to Talk Across America. I'm Doug Miles, and we're here in beautiful Sarasota, Florida.
Great to welcome a woman you've seen on TV, both nationally and locally here in the Tampa Bay area in the past. And she's written a really interesting novel, kind of based on her career. You know her from her work as the former White House correspondent for CNN. She's also been on ABC and MSNBC, but she's written a novel called Savage News. And we're joined today by great journalist Jessica Yellin on the telephone. Jessica, good to talk with you. How are you?
I'm great, and I'm so happy to be back in the Tampa market.
I was going
to
say,
WTVT, shout out.
You got it, WTVT in Tampa, and you were there at a very interesting time. It was a big story then, 2000, the recount story. I guess that was one of the big ones you had to do back then, right?
It was an unbelievable experience, yes. I worked with the most amazing people at WTVT. They trained me in what it is to be a TV journalist, and I was covering politics in the year 2000. I was in Tallahassee election night, covering Bill Nelson's election to the Senate, and a recount broke out. I covered it for 35 days from Tallahassee.
Yeah, we know
it launched my political career.
We know it well here with Catherine Harris, who is based right here in Sarasota. So
yes.
I had the chance to talk to her, but that was an incredible story. That I guess they'll be studying that for years. What happened, right?
Yes. I should say it launched my career covering politics. But yes, what an amazing moment.
Yeah, I was going to say.
And things have only gotten crazier since then.
Yeah, it has. Yeah. Before that, though, were you a political person? Did you find interest in that? Or were you just kind of assigned that and then you became interested in politics?
I was always interested in covering mm-hmm. politics. Like the main character in my book, Savage News, the character is called Natalie Savage. And like her, I always wanted to cover the White House. I thought, and Natalie thinks, that the White House is a place where what you do every day matters. Your reporting can make a difference. And so I aspired to get there. And the story is a version, a much more comic, exaggerated version of what some of that trajectory can look like for a young reporter.
I was going to say, I mean, obviously you've lived it, so you can bring a lot of reality to it. And reading the book, from what I understand of the job, a friend of mine down here, I don't know if you've ever met him, Gary Shuster, he's a former White House correspondent for CBS, and he's told a lot of stories about how that works. So I think you've really captured at least the inner workings of what you do in that job, and then you have a great story around it.
Thank you. What I tried to do is tell a fun and funny story. So this young woman, Natalie, it gets to the White House. She always wanted to cover it, and she gets the chance to cover it just as the First Lady disappears. So she's sent off to cover these over-the-top absurd stories that appear to be a sex scandal. But along the way, she thinks that something more serious is going on, and so she tries to get the real story. And, you know, she encounters all kinds of obstacles, her boss criticizing how her hair looks and her appearance and not wanting her to report an exclusive because no one else is reporting it, so how do we know it's true? And all the pressures of, you know, being in an always breaking news environment. So it's meant to be fun with a little poke at reality.
And you talk in the book as well, there's a competition between your character, Natalie Savage, and some other person it's sort of based a little bit on you, but another person in the book that is competing for that plum assignment as well, and he's kind of more of a reality star. So, I mean, that's almost happens in real life too, doesn't it?
Yeah, the guy she's competing against is now a journalist, but he made his national fame competing in a reality show. Yeah. And she's set up to win the White House job with him. Whoever gets the highest ratings wins. So that exact thing has never happened to me, and I've never heard that exact thing happen in real life. But I'm kind of like taking reality and turning it up a few notches. And sure, you see reporters, you know, sort of vie for the same job, and you see the influence of reality TV on the news and how we cover politics, especially in our current moment.
Yeah, you know, I was saying the competition part of it, whether it's you know, the reality show or not, but that's real. And you're competing for the stories, you know, getting the microphone in there and all that. So that's a day-to-day existence, isn't it?
You know, one of the things I found is the competition is real. Often it's management that tries to pit you guys against each other. Mm-hmm. And so that happens, but there's like on the road, you really do develop these tight bonds with the other journalists. And so I try to depict some of that, like what it's like to be on the adventure of reporting a story, yeah. Which is one of the things that I miss most having left network news.
I was going to say, you do so much writing as a journalist, but this is a little bit different type of writing. As a novelist, were there different challenges that came up that you maybe didn't expect when you decided to write a book like this?
Oh, my gosh. Yes. Well, in news, as you know, you have an assignment at whatever, 7, 8 a.m., and you're on air with it by 4 p.m., and then you're usually done. So it's quick decision-making, quick turns and out. With a novel, it just stays with you. This took me 3.5 years to write, and it doesn't leave you day and night. Also, most TV spots that I wrote run about a minute 30, a minute 45 if spoken. And when I first sat down to write the novel, all my stories came out to about the length of a minute 30, a minute 45 if spoken. That is not how you write a novel. So I had to break myself of that habit.
Did you write it, plot it out, maybe the story in 10 or 15 pages and work that way, or how did you go about it?
I tried. I tried to write a whole plot and then break it down chapter by chapter, but it turns out, like anything, it's a craft, and you have to learn what the conventions are for it to kind of work. And I didn't get there until I found some really great editors who helped me kind of solve some of those plot questions. And once I started working with an editor, it just becomes a magic experience because you got the stories and you got the characters and now you know where to take them.
And again, I always like to ask novelists that we have on the show, when you write the dialogue, did you enjoy that part? And also did the character maybe go, Natalie Savage, go in a little bit different direction than you thought originally?
Yes. There are things that happen in a novel that you don't expect to happen. Like, at one point, Natalie gets something wrong on air. And I would never wish that on Natalie, and I lived in panic, anxiety of that happening to me. I sort of made her live out my own personal anxiety nightmare of getting a big story wrong. But mostly, the fun parts were, there's a scene in the book where the DC Bureau is freaking out because the breaking news banner has crashed, and they're live on air without the words breaking news on television. What are they going to do? That kind of thing was fun to write because I'm sending up the conventions of cable news. Obviously, that's not an actual story, but it's a satirical take. And that kind of thing, thinking up those, how to poke fun at these various things was really a delight, and writing that was my favorite part.
Yeah, you mentioned that breaking news. I was going to ask you about that. If everything's breaking news, nothing's breaking news. I think they got to pull that back. I know why they do it, and you know why they do it, but it's too much. Enough.
Yeah. I like to say right now, everything's a mountain, nothing's a molehill.
Right, right.
And we could be doing a better job of helping people distinguish the two.
And then people, after a while, don't pay attention because, well, we see that all the time. I think they have to use it more sparingly, but what do I know? They seem to be doing okay, but...
No, I agree. I'm afraid we're going to give people outrage fatigue. And in fact, it's one of the reasons I've started reporting, this is strange maybe, but I've started reporting the news on Instagram at my handle, at Jessica Yellin. And what I do is I kind of distill what I say, the news from the noise. These are the molehills, don't worry. This is the mountain, here's what it means, out. So I think people need a little bit of news without a panic attack, I say.
You almost want to go back to the day, you know, when I was a kid in New York, you had the local news, but you watched either Walter Cronkite or Huntley Brinkley, whoever was on then, or Peter Jennings and those guys. You got your half hour, and that's all you needed. Now you got too much.
100%.
It's off the top.
And people need help distilling. Yeah.
But we want people to get this book. Again, if you like to see kind of the behind the scenes of what goes on, but in an entertaining way, Savage News, it's a novel. Former CNN Chief White House Correspondent Jessica Yellin has been with us today. And Jessica, I know you gave the Instagram, but you want to give out a website or other information to get the book?
Yes, you can buy the book online. Now it's live for sale. And you can follow me on Instagram at Jessica Yellin, Yellin, and also Twitter. And the link to buy the book is there as well.
Great. I know you also still do some broadcast work, right? I saw an interview on YouTube recently with some people, so you keep your hand in it that way, right?
I'm still in the game. It's really, who could miss out on this moment?
That's it. A lot going on. Jessica, pleasure talking to you. Welcome back for a few minutes to our market, and we'll hopefully talk to you again.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us today on Talk Across America. Please visit our website at DougMilesMedia.com for more great interviews and content. And if you're interested in any of the books we talk about on the program, please click the Amazon link on our website. It helps support the podcast. Thanks for listening. We'll see you again real soon here from beautiful Sarasota, Florida.
I'm Stan Brock. 30 years ago, I formed Remote Area Medical to help people overseas. But then we found generations of families in America isolated by poverty from the health care they need. Together, we can take dental, vision, and medical help to 1 million adults and their kids, right here at home in the United States of America.